I'm going to use my telepathic powers to advance the slides. Ah, there's help. So I'm going to talk to you about the Cloud Foundry phenomenon. Tonight, you're all here because you know that it is the best time in human history to be a developer. That's because it's also the best time in human history for open source. This used to be something crazy, an insane collection of academics who thought computer science is something like math and everything should be free. Well, guess what? It should be. They were right, and you're here. That has given rise to the Cloud Foundry phenomenon. So our community is collaborative. It's open. We've got interesting speakers. This is Cory Doctorow from the Electronic Frontier Foundation, looking at openness and freedom from every angle. Most importantly, we sit around together in person. We solve the digital divide of arguing over emails and instant messenger. And we actually work together around our own tables. Here are the things that bind us together. We believe that it's the dawn of a new era. We believe that you're carrying supercomputers in your pockets. We believe that you're driving supercomputers down the highways. Because Wi-Fi is so cheap, we're going to put internet on all the things. Internet, all the things. Because we can, there's been a shift in human behavior. So who here has looked at their supercomputer since this show started? Okay, now be honest, who has looked at this supercomputer since I started talking? That's a change in human behavior. Guess what? That's where you're making decisions. That's where you're consuming information. That's where your business is going to live and die. There is a shift in business matching the shift in human behavior. If you don't make the shift, the stakes are high. Since 2000, 52% of the Fortune 500 are no longer on the list. That is an epic level of mortality. It's not just that we are getting older and feeling like things are going faster. My son is now 18 and going to college in the same college I went to, UC San Diego, studying physics. That makes me feel old, knowing he's going to the exact same place. It is actually speeding up. And Rita Gunter-McGrath, who's a professor at the Columbia Business School, looked at the last 30 years of business and divided it into two epochs of 15 years each. And the first half was slow. The second half went fast. Looking at that, she wanted to come up with a recipe for how can you survive. The most important thing that I took away from her book, and I recommend you read it yourself, is you must have an innovation proficiency. When we talk about innovation, we often point sort of in a fuzzy way at Amazon and Netflix, but what is innovation really? It's about speed, right? Amazon's pace of innovation has been blistering, right? Year over year, they're producing from single digits to tens to hundreds of new services. At their reInvent last year, they announced that they did 500 new services just in 2015. Imagine if you were producing 500 new services for your business every year. How would you get there? It's because their baseline is sharing by default. Open source is not crazy. Open source is not just algorithms. Open source is embracing basic economic principles that says we need to share. When we share non-rival goods like software, it accelerates all of us. It takes discipline, though. So here's a love letter from Jeff Bezos to his organization back in the 2000s to give them the religion. I'll summarize it for you. All teams will henceforth expose their data and functionality through service interfaces. That's APIs. Anyone who doesn't do this will be fired. Thank you. Have a nice day. There's actually an Easter egg in there. He didn't really say, thank you. Have a nice day. So that's how they get this kind of pace, right? Discipline and commitment, because their new baseline is sharing by default. Now, there are a few researchers at MIT who put together a book called Platform Revolution. It's out now. It's by Jeffrey Parker, Marshall Van Alsten, and Sangreet Chowdhury. They looked at a bunch of different business models that we've all heard of. And we wonder, there are 60 slides, and I have 600 seconds, so they're going to go fast. But I will post the entire deck. It's all Creative Commons. So they looked at these businesses, and they thought, wow, what do they have in common? Why is it always up and to the right? Why has competition changed? Why is it that McGraw-Hill and Houghton Mifflin Harcourt don't look at each other as the competition? It's not book publishers, it's a non-book publisher. It's not NBC and CBS media companies, it's Netflix taking it all away. This fundamental basis of competition has changed because the new baseline is sharing by default. How do I share my movies? How do I share my cars? Do you know Uber's valuation is higher than that of Toyota? It's about the same valuation as Ford? They don't make any cars because they've figured out how to do sharing. What gets me excited, and the reason I'm excited to be here at OTS, is startups are easy. I've done 5 startups, I've been at 4 big companies. Startups have no constraints, they can do anything. They're all so hard, the companies can die. But when you take the leaders in insurance, in heavy industry, in telecommunications, and they start getting this sharing by default, crazy things happen. So GE announced the launch of Predix last week. Pretty epic software. This is a cloud just for the Internet of Things, for heavy industry, for managing giant things, aircraft, trains, power plants, hospitals. Why hasn't that revolution made it to your supercomputer yet? Oh, it has. What if you could manage all of that infrastructure from your phone? But that code's got to be written somewhere. So here's the coolest line that I've seen in a long time. Yeah, you need to write code that runs on wind turbines. Where are you going to put it? You're going to put it on Cloud Foundry. And you can just CF push to a wind turbine. That is the basis of continuous innovation, knowing that you can make changes all the time, in real time, have them land on the servers. No change is going to kill you because you've got an entire stack. Continuous integration, your code is always up to date. Everybody knows the true good state of your infrastructure. Continuous delivery, getting all that stuff to production. Continuous innovation is a result. Building business value, making changes day by day, minute by minute, to make sure that your learning about the market is immediately reflected in what you have to offer. But there's a catch. Most people talk about continuous delivery, but they don't actually have it. It still takes 6 months to provision a server. It's not quite the same as an API call in 6 seconds. That's an anti-pattern. Have any of you living through this? So if that feels horrible, good, it should feel horrible. Water scrumfall. It's a beautiful little agile thing stuck in the middle of a very slow process. So to get out of the water scrumfall, you need to enter a new world. It's one built of microservices, bits of code, tens or hundreds of lines, not thousands, or millions, containers, consistently packaged images that can be run on any set of infrastructure, 12-factor applications. Take out the state, take out the security, take out the identity, put it in a service that you can rely on it across all the apps. This produces a world that is ephemeral, it's scalable, it's agile. It's ephemeral because everything's coming and going quickly. Containers arise, containers depart. Network routes arise, network routes depart. It's scalable because now we can just add up more capacity, or we can shrink that capacity, right? And it's agile because no one change will kill you. You can keep making changes all the time. We run in the cloud. We support any client device because we know there'll be 50 billion devices in a couple of years. Most of them haven't been invented yet. So we have to be able to prepare for unpredictable clients. We have to be able to connect the legacy data and process via APIs. If you don't, you'll join the Fortune, the Global 2000 and Fortune 500 who aren't on the list. A quick view of Cloud Foundry is it's a platform that brings everything together. We run on OpenStack all the time. I'd say probably half of our deployments globally are on OpenStack. But we also run on Amazon. We also run on VMware vSphere because we believe that you need multi-cloud. And SoftLayer. We know your apps need to run wherever you want them to. We know you need an elastic runtime to scale them up and down. You need a services tier to be able to attach to the things that you care about. Things in your company or outside your company, like Twilio or some API that you found on API Harmony. And operations, a lights out operations platform that just lets things scale up and scale down without adding extra administrators. It's about right sizing digital innovation like the Japanese did at Toyota in the 1950s. Focus on cycle time optimization, smaller teams and faster tools. Bring dev and ops together. That's what Cloud Foundry is for. Harmonizing dev and ops to give you innovation at speed. Now there's a little bit of a quick history lesson here. We owe a lot of heritage to great thinking by companies like Google, inventing Borg and donating C groups to the Linux kernel. All of these technologies you'll hear about, they have a shared history, but they have a different orientation. So Cloud Foundry is a platform as opposed to a do-it-yourself approach. It's not an either or, you can do whatever you want, but when you need things to run, when you need logging, when you need staging, when you need core services, when you need a service broker, when you need a database that has the true state of the system at all times, you're going to pick Cloud Foundry. In the past, it wasn't as open as it could be, but now we've brought in a new era of open collaboration through foundations. With the existence of open containers, we've been able to work with Docker and the Docker community to run Docker directly on Cloud Foundry, to be able to say containers are built in and we love them all, because the new baseline is sharing by default. Because the new baseline is sharing by default, here are all the companies shipping Cloud Foundry. So when I talk about multi-cloud, I also mean multi-vendor. I mean multiple footprints. I mean multiple deployment models. Because you need to not care where your app needs to go in the future. You just need to build a great app and move it wherever it needs to go. Because that new baseline is sharing by default, we find that customers love it. My favorite headline from last year. We had nothing to do with this. Bank of New York Mellon and JPMorgan Chase came to the Wall Street Journal and said, Cloud Foundry prevents vendor lock-in. We love this. So does the US government. So if you go to cloud.gov, you'll find some of the best documentation of a Cloud Foundry infrastructure anywhere. The foundation has grown. We are blessed by the goodwill and strength of many of you in the room. We're privileged to have many users among our ranks. It's not just vendors. It is being balanced to this environment, balanced to this open source project so that producers, consumers become equal. So in this process of rebalancing the system towards user-driven roadmaps and control of the upstream project, we're also diving in deeply to particular areas, financial services, industrial IoT, telecommunications, and government. And we have focused at the foundation on certification to guarantee portability of apps across clouds, to make it lasting and durable, and to build the ecosystem of opportunity. So with that, Cloud Foundry is certified. I'm very proud to say that IBM BlueMix was one of the very first companies to certify on Cloud Foundry, and that we share a wonderful common vision.